Hello, hi, a very, very happy good evening to everyone. So this is Krishnaveni and we've been talking about the story. Story of life on Earth, and that's biology. So hello, hi, a very, very happy good evening. So this is Krishnaveni and we've been talking about the story of life on Earth, and that's biology. So welcome to my session. So today we are in lecture 3 of syllabus wrap-up series. So we are going to put an end to your animal kingdom. So I have taught animal kingdom, then I did a revision of animal kingdom. Now we are talking about the syllabus wrap-up of animal kingdom. So by now, if you are watching all my lectures, you should be very thorough with animal kingdom, because along with you, even I learned animal kingdom. So now I am thorough. So let's see if you are thorough. So for all those who are new to my session, so Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I teach a class to a 12 topic, and Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, I teach a class 11 topic. So come on guys, please do like, share and subscribe. So let your friends know, here I am teaching Animal Kingdom, the entire syllabus for NEET Biology. Yes, make it quick. Okay, so let's finish off Animal Kingdom. So I have a set of 10 questions at the end. So we'll talk about the 10 questions as well. Hi Anthony Abhi, a very, very happy good evening. So thank you so much for joining my lecture. So please do like, share and subscribe. So let's quickly finish because we have quite a portion left. So the animal kingdom. So what are the topics that we were talking about? We were talking about the basis of classification and the classification of animals. On what basis they are classified and what are the classifications that we have? Okay. So first thing, a quick recap of what are the points on which we are classifying animal system. So do you remember? And what are the bases we are classifying animal system? Okay, so the first thing, so just give me a minute. Okay, so first we have classified based on the level of organization. So what is the level of organization that we classified? So whether it is cellular, whether it is tissue, organ, or organ system level of classification. So that was the first thing. The next one is the symmetry. So whether it had symmetry or not. So what are the three types of symmetry? First one is asymmetry, when you get irregular pieces. Then you have your radial symmetry. Then you have your bilateral symmetry. So bilateral is when you get two identical right and left halves. Radial is when you get two identical halves. Hi Vinu, hi. So hello, good evening. How are you? Are you fine? Are you fine, Vinu? Now you're perfectly fine. So thank you so much for joining my lecture guys. So please do like, share and subscribe. Hi FF lover. So I hope you are doing good. So thank you so much both of you for joining my session. So please do like, share and subscribe. Okay, so this is about symmetry. So the third one is the pattern of digestive and circulatory system. So circulatory system, we describe it as open and closed. Digestive system, we say whether it is complete or incomplete digestive system. So when do we say incomplete? When you have only one opening through which you take in food and which you excrete. So when there is only one opening, it is incomplete. So we say complete when you have a separate passage like mouth and anus for ingestion and ingestion. Okay, so the fourth one is coelom. So coelom is a gut cavity that is present. So based on this, we have classified. So we have 11 phyla talking about your animal kingdom. So it starts with phylum Porphyra. Then we had your Coelenterata, then we had your Ctenophora, Platyhelminthes, Then we spoke about your askahelminthes. Then we also discussed about your annelids. And then we also spoke about your orthopods in the previous lecture. Yes, I hope you remember. So as we go up the level of hierarchy, so the level of organization also increases. So apart from this, we also spoke about diploblastic or triploblastic. We also spoke about segmentation, what is metamerism, and finally about notochord. So only a chordate possesses a notochord. So all others are non-chordates, they do not have a notochord. Hi Vishal, hello, thank you so much for joining my lecture. So please do like, share and subscribe. So Vinu says throat pain is there. Okay, so please take care. So take in hot water. So drink something which is very spicy for your throat, which can kill a lot of microbes. Okay, yes, it is very painful. Yes, so tomorrow at 6:30 we are meeting. So I'm going to talk about the precautions, how to stay safe and how to stay strong. So please do join for my session. Yes, so please take in steam, so that is also helpful. Okay Vinu, hello Shimpi, hi, good evening. So thank you so much for joining my lecture. So please do like, share and subscribe. So these are the points. So in porphyra, so the members are sponges, they are mostly marine, but one of them is fresh water. Okay, so the freshwater sponge is known as spongilla. So this freshwater sponge can enter into an unfavorable state when there is can enter into a dormant state when there is unfavorable condition. So that dormant state is known as gemmules. So just like you have spore formation, your sponges, freshwater sponge forms gemmule. Okay, yes. Yes, my own energy also remains the same. Okay, so I enjoy taking class. So however tired I am, the moment I come here, I become fresh. So I don't know. Okay, so this is gemmules. So apart from this, sponges have a water canal system. So what is so special about this water canal system? It helps in filtering water. So there are three parts of this water canal system. First is spores, that is called as ostia. Then you have your water cavity, that is called a spongocele. And then you have your osculum. So this water cavity has cells which are known as scholar cells or your spongocytes. Fine. So this is about your sponges. The next one we went on to talk about your coelenterates. So coelenterates are where we spoke about your hydra. So coelenterates are also known as cnidarians or your nematocysts, because they contain a stinging capsule in the tentacles or in the hydra. Yes, ma'am. Good evening. So thank you so much for joining my session. So please do like, share and subscribe. Hi Naveen, hello. So thank you Naveen for joining my session. So everyone please take care, because health is more important. So nothing is going to come and save us. Okay. Yes, so this is cnidarians. So here what did we talk about? So here you have a gastrovascular cavity, and that has an opening that is called as, that is similar to mouth, and the name of the opening is your hypostome. So your coelenterates can be of two types. It can have two types of body forms. One is polyp, the other one is medusa. So polyp is your polyp is sessile, meaning it is immobile, it cannot move, and it is cylindrical shaped, whereas your medusa is umbrella shaped and it can freely move. Yes, that is echinodermata. So that is your water canal system. So that is also different. So this we call it as your water transport system. This transports water. Yes, both are same, but echinodermata is still well developed. So that is the difference. Okay. Yes. So in coelenterates, we spoke about a list of examples as well. So then talking about your ctenophora. So ctenophora is also known as comb jellies, or it has is also known as sea walnut. Yes, so those two names are given to your ctenophora. So your coelenterates and your ctenophora are almost similar. So I told you to make a tabular column talking about the level of organization. So this is cellular level, this is tissue level, this is also tissue level. So what is symmetry? So your sponges are asymmetric. So these two are radial symmetry. So then talking about your platyhelminthes. So platyhelminthes are your flatworms, right? So what is so unique about your platyhelminthes? So platyhelminths have what is called as flame cells or your solenocytes. So which help in excretion and osmoregulation, right? So who are the members of your platyhelminths? So we have your tapeworms, that is tania. So those are examples of your platyhelminths. The next one is your ascaehelminths. So ascaehelminths are your roundworms. So roundworms are the only phyla which has a pseudo coelome. So before this, all of them do not possess a coelom. So everything is acoelomate. So this is pseudo coelomate. So what do they have for their respiratory system? For their excretion. So flame cells. So flame cells in case of platyhelminths, here they have an excretory tube, and they have well developed pharynx. So these are the points that we read under your roundworms, that is ascaehelminths. So who are the examples here? So you have your ascaris, you have your leech, all this. So the next one, we spoke about your annelids. So annelids talk about your earthworm. So what do annelids have for excretion? They have your nephridia, right? So you have aquatic as well as terrestrial. So aquatic one is your nereids, and the terrestrial one is your Ferritema. This is your earthworm. So this nereids has structures for moving. So that is parapodia. So Ferritema is hermaphrodite. It has both male and female organ within the same organism. So nereids is dioecious. It has a male and female separately. Yes, hello. So thank you so much for joining my session. I'm fine and thank you. So please do like, share and subscribe. Okay, so this is annelida. So the last one that we spoke about is your orthopods. So orthopod, this is the largest phyla of your animal kingdom. So among this, the 2/3 are insects. So orthopods means appendages which help in movement. So here the body is segmented into head, thorax and abdomen. So I hope you remember cockroach, head, thorax and abdomen. So what else did we talk about in orthopods? They have your malpighian tubules for osmoregulation and excretion. And they have a closed circulatory system. So here they have an open circulatory system. So whenever you're talking about orthopods, if you forget any point, remember a cockroach so that you will be able to correlate. Okay. So it has an open circulatory system. Then we spoke about the 5 classes of your orthopods. I hope you remember them and the examples. So with this, we ended last lecture and we also solved some questions. Now moving forward to the next phyla, that is molluscus. So what is unique about molluscus? Okay, so before this only I have discussed all this. So we are here. So today we'll talk about molluscus, echinodermata, hemichordata and finally chordata. So moving forward. So yes, this is already done. So now phylum molluscus. So they are basically shelled organisms. So how do you remember? You remember orthopods as insects, right? So you remember molluscus as shelled organisms. Fine. Yes, Shimpi, you're right. It is bilateral triploblastic, that is annelids. Yes, so annelids are the first one that is bilateral. No, I guess your ascaehelminths are also bilateral, right? No, bilateral starts with your platyhelminths. Okay, so moving forward to phylum Mollusca. So who are the members? So they are the second largest members of the animal phylum. So first one is your orthopod. The second one is your phylum Mollusca. So where is the habitat? They can be terrestrial and as well as aquatic. Just like your annelids, they can be terrestrial as well. They can be aquatic as well. So what is the level of organization? So here it is organ system level, it is triploblastic. So this is a higher organism, so the symmetry is bilateral and they have coelome. So this answers all the first 4 types of fundamental features that we were discussing. So once again, molluscs are the second largest animal phylum. So the habitat here is terrestrial and aquatic, just like your annelids. They can live in water, they can live in land as well. Okay, so the next one, the level of organization is your organ system level. Yes, they have coil digestive system. Yes, you are right, FF. So symmetry, bilateral symmetry, they are triploblastic and they are coelomate. They contain a coelom. So how is the body designed? So they are made up of a calcareous cell. In case of your arthropods, they have an exoskeleton made up of chitin, right? So here they have a calcareous shell, and apart from that, the body is divided into head, foot and a hump. They have a head, hump and a foot. So apart from that, the next unique feature is, if they have a hump, they have a cavity or a layer surrounding the hump. So if this is the hump, they have a layer over the hump. This is called as your mantle. So the space between the hump and the mantle is called as the mantle cavity. Fine. So mantle over the hump, and the space between it is called as the mantle cavity. So what about the respiratory and excretory functions? So both are present. So you have excretory system as well as respiratory system. That is why it is organ system level. So organ system level tells you that when one or two organs interact, that forms your organ system level. So when you have only one organ, then it is not organ system level, it is organ level. Okay, so they have two legs, they have a pair of legs. Okay, yes. So the next unique feature is, they have an anterior head, and in this head they have sensory tentacles. So just like so they have tentacles in their anterior head. So in case of arthropods, you call them as antenna. So here they have sensory tentacles which help them sense the environmental conditions. The next, they have a mouth-like organ, but here we will not say mouth, we call it as radula. So molluscs has a lot of points to remember. So number one, it is the second largest phyla. It can live on land, it can live on water. So it has organ system level, bilateral, triploblastic and coelomate. So the body is made up of calcareous cell compared to your orthopoda, which is made up of chitinous exoskeleton. So here the body is divided into head, foot and hump. So hump is surrounded by mantle. In between the hump and mantle, you have a mantle cavity. Okay, so here you have respiratory and excretory functions present. So in the head you have sensory tentacles, you have a mouth like feeding organ which is known as radula. So reproduction, it is dioecious, meaning you have a separate male and female, and fertilization is indirect, so oviparous. So oviparous means they are egg laying. So fertilization happens outside, so it can also happen inside the female, and the female can lay egg. It can be, there can be two possibilities, but they are egg laying. So who are the examples of your molluscs? The first one is your apple snail. So I guess your binomial name will be tough to remember, so go with the common name. So Pila is your apple snail. Then you have pearl oyster. Then cuttlefish. So cuttlefish and your silverfish are not fishes exactly. So your silverfish comes under phylum Arthropoda. Your cuttlefish comes under phylum Molluscus. So please don't get confused. Then you have your squid. Then you have your devilfish. So devilfish is octopus. I guess this is easy to remember. Then you have sea hare. Then you have tusk shell and chitin. So all these are examples. So remember cuttlefish here. So remember octopus, then sometimes they ask you about your apple snail. So these are repeated examples. So moving on to the next phyla. So the next phyla is Echinodermata. So talking about your Echinodermata. So the Echinodermata, so why it got the name Echinodermata? Just like why your Coelenterata has a name known as Cnidarians. So why Echinodermatans are called as Echinodermata is because they have endoskeleton of calcareous ossicles. So if you look into the starfish, so starfish is an example of your Echinodermata. Okay, it has spiny parts on its body. Okay, so that is the reason it is called as Echinodermata. So if you look at starfish, okay, the figure is not clear. It has spiny structures on the body. The body surface is not smooth. So that is the reason it is called as Echinodermata. So it has an endoskeleton So endoskeleton is on the inside. It is made up of calcareous ossicles. So ossicles are formed by the fusion of bone. So that is why it is called as echinodermata. So their habitat is exclusively marine. They cannot be terrestrial. Okay. So organization is organ system level, and they are coelomates. They are triploblastic. But in symmetry, there is a small twist. So the adult one is radial symmetry. The larvae has bilateral symmetry. So pay attention. So long when we are talking about symmetry. So starting from your porphyra, your coelentrata, your ctenophora, your platyhelminthes, your aschelminthes, your annelids, your orthopoda, your molluscus. So how was the symmetry? How was the symmetry? So this was asymmetric. So this was radial. This was radial. So we are moving high up the hierarchy. So this was bilateral. Everything apart from above your platyhelminthes was bilateral, right? So in case of echinodermata, you have a small twist. So what is this twist? So your larval stage has bilateral symmetry, but when the larva develops into adult, it has radial symmetry. So radial symmetry is present in less developed phyla. So here the larva has a well advanced symmetry, that is bilateral symmetry, whereas the adult has radial symmetry. So radial symmetry is a characteristic of lower phyla like your coelentrates and your ctenophora. So such a kind of symmetry is known as retrograde development. So ideally it should have been vice versa. If the larva had radial symmetry and your adult had bilateral symmetry, yes, it is a normal development. But it's the reverse. The adult is having a lesser form of symmetry. So such a kind of reverse order is known as retrograde development. So what is retro? You go for old songs, right? So you remake the old songs, you're going back to the old stage. So since this is going back to the less developed stage, so such a kind of development is known as retrograde development. Okay, yes, it is called as hedgehog skin. Okay, I hope you understood the symmetry. So that is the tricky part in your echinodermata. So always a question comes, what is the symmetry of the adult and what is the symmetry of the larvae in case of your echinodermata? So then digestion. So here the digestion is complete. So when do we say complete? When you have two openings, one for taking food and one for excreting the food. So here they have a mouth as well. Here they have an anus as well. So that is why it is a complete digestive system. So what is the unique feature? So here they have a water vascular system. So water vascular means circulation. So here they have a circulating water system, whereas in case of porphyra, the water does not circulate. The water enters inside, gets filtered, and it moves out. It does not circulate inside the sponges. So that is the main difference between the water canal system in your porphyra as well as your water vascular system in case of your echinodermata. Okay, so this water vascular system is a type of circulation. So this helps in locomotion, capture and transport of food, and it also aids in respiration. So all these are aided by the water vascular system. So then the excretory system is absent here. So reproduction, the sexes are separate. So it is a dioecious organism. So it only reproduces by sexual means. So fertilization is external. So the development is indirect. Okay, so both of them releases the gamete. The gametes meets on the water because it is a marine organism. So here the medium of fertilization is water. So examples are your starfish. Okay, I guess I have the examples in the next slide. Yes, so Astriasis, this is the starfish, sea urchin, sea lily, sea cucumber, brittle star. So frequently asked example is your sea cucumber, sea urchin. So these are the examples. So sometimes Antidon is mentioned. So Antidon belongs to which phyla, or what is unique about Antidon? So that is your water vascular system. So these three terms are important. They repeatedly ask. Okay. So vascular means circulation. When I say a vascular system in plants, it is your xylem and phloem, right? So what do? They help in the transport. They help in the movement. So that is called as vascular system. Okay. Hi, Sweetie Creator. Yes, after a long time you're here. So thank you so much for joining my lecture. So please do like, share, and subscribe. So you played a mentee on reproductive health, and you got third rank in 300 out of 300 students. Wow, that is commendable. So many, many congratulations. Which means you're very strong in reproductive health. Very good, Sweetie Creator. Okay. Yes, so this is about the examples of your echinodermata. So moving forward to the next one, the next phyla is your hemichordata. So talking about your hemichordata, so hemichordata are worm-like marine animals. So they are also marine. So the level of organization is your organ system level. So symmetry is bilateral, triploblastic, coelomate. So how is the body designed here? So the body is cylindrical, but it is divided into three parts. Okay. So you have an anterior proboscis. Anterior is the top. So for me, anterior portion is my head. Posterior is my legs. So the anterior portion is proboscis, then you have collar, and then you have trunk. So that is how the body is designed. In case of orthopods, it is head, neck, and thorax. So here it is proboscis, collar, and trunk. The next one, circulatory system is open type. Circulatory system is also open in case of your orthopods. So this is how you link and study, so that you do not forget the points. So respiration takes place through gills. So we are coming into fish type of categories, but not exactly. So excretory organ is your proboscis gland. So the anterior proboscis contains your glomerulus like structure. So in humans, glomerulus filters blood, right? So you have a similar structures in your proboscis. So reproduction, the sexes are separate, so it is a dioecious organism. So fertilization is indirect, and the development, fertilization is external, so development is also indirect. So examples, you have only two, balanoglossus and saculoglossus. They belong to your hemichordata. So moving into the next largest phyla, or the last phyla, it is your phylum chordata. So before this, till hemichordata, from Porphyra till hemichordata, they were known as non-chordates. Porphyra to hemichordata, they were broadly known as non-chordates. So ideally, your animal kingdom is divided into non-chordates and chordates. So under your non-chordates, you had the first 10 phyla. So the last phyla is your phylum chordata. So talking about your phylum chordata, so here, what is the main difference between chordates and non-chordates? So this is a very important tableau column. This is directly from NCRT. So please do not skip any important tableau column from your NCRT. So chordates, here your notochords are present. So that is why they are called as chordates. So notochord is mesodermally derived rod-like structure. Okay, so that is present in chordates. In your non-chordates, notochord is absent. That is the primary difference. So next, they have a central nervous system, which is dorsal. So your nervous system is at the back. It is hollow and it is single. Okay, so here the nervous system is ventral in the front portion of the body, like in case of your cockroach, solid, and it is double. So pharynx is perforated by gill slits. So pharynx is what? It is a common passage for wind and foot pipe. So in case of chordates, not all chordates, some chordates have gill slits. Here that is absent. The heart is ventral. For us, heart is on the ventral side. Here it is on the dorsal side, if at all, if it's present. So they have a post-anal trail. So here the post-anal trail is absent. This is general for chordates. I do not mean that all chordates have this features, okay? No, we still have chordates. So chordates is the biggest part. So here we have so many tableau columns. Okay, Shimpi? Yes, so phylum chordata. So it is further divided into subphylum. So this is a phylum. Now it is divided into subphylum. So urochordata or tunicata. So urochordata is also known as tunicata. Otherwise, it is known as, urochordata or tunicata. So this is the first subphylum. So this is subphylum 1. The next one, cephalochordata. So this is subphylum 2. The last one, the subphylum 3 is your vertebrata. So, vertebrata is a subphylum of your phylum Chordata. So, here you should be thorough with the mnemonic. So, what is that mnemonic? All chordates are not vertebrates, but all vertebrates are chordates. So, see if you understand. So, statement 1, all chordates are not vertebrates. Of course, because you have two other segments. So, this statement has been explained. The next one, all vertebrates are chordates. Because vertebrate comes under chordate, right? So, all vertebrates are chordates, but all chordates are not vertebrates because you have two other subphyla here. Okay, clear? So, moving forward to the next part. So, your urochordata or tunicata and your cephalochordates together, they are called as protochordates. The first occurred chordates. So, that is why they are called as protochordates. So, talking about your difference between your protochordates, you have two protochordates. One is your urochordata, the other one is your cephalochordata, right? So, urochordata is marine. Cephalochordata is also marine. So, cephalo means head. Okay. So, notochord is present only in the larval tail. So, in urochordata, your notochord is present only in the larval stage. In the adult stage, you do not have your notochord. In case of cephalochordates, notochord exists from the head to the tail and it is present throughout the life. So, this is the main difference between both the type of protochordates. So, example in case of your urochordata, Acidica, Scalpa, Dolium. Okay, Acidia, Scalpa, Dolium are the examples. So, AST. Okay. So, as you study, you feel depressed. So, that is how you remember this. So, as you study, so U is not there. As you study, you get depressed. True, no? As you study Animal Kingdom, you get all the more depressed. Oh my God, how am I going to clear? I should have taken JE, right? How many of you thought the same? Okay, so here there is only one example, that is your branchiostoma. So, this is the example of your cephalochordates. So, moving forward, so this is your protochordates, the first formed chordates. So, moving forward to the next one, it is your cyclostomata. So, talking about your cyclostomata, so here they are ectoparasites. So, what are ectoparasites? Which live outside the surface. So, endo is inside, ecto is outside. So, they are ectoparasites on what? On your fishes. Okay? So, design, so okay, respiration. So, first let's talk about respiration. So, you have 6 to 15 pairs of gill slits. So, gill slits were your characteristic of your chordates, right? So, you have 6 to 15 pairs of your gill slits. So, the design is sucking and circular mouth without jaws. So, they lack jaws. So, cyclostomata, they do not have jaws, they do not have fins, they do not have scales. So, that is the primary difference. They are devoid of scales. Devoid means without or lacking. So, that is the meaning of devoid of scales and paired fins. Fine. So, then vertebral column. So, vertebral column is also a part of your chordates. So, they have a cranium, that is a skull, and a vertebral column, which is cartilaginous. For us, both are bony, right? It is not cartilaginous. We have cartilaginous joint, but it is bony in our case. So, here it is cartilaginous. Then, circulation, here it is closed type, meaning blood vessels are well developed. So, unique feature, they are mostly marine because they live as parasites on fishes. They are mostly marine, but they migrate to fresh water for spawning. So, what is spawning? So, spawning is the process of releasing eggs. So, they release eggs only in fresh water. Once again, the egg hatches in the fresh water and when they develop, they move back to the marine water. So, that is how it happens. So, once you are born, so what happens? They send you to school, right? So, after everything is done, you come back to home. So, they are born in fresh water. They migrate to marine water for their lifestyle. So, once again, when they have to release it, they come back to the fresh water. It is something similar to that. So the larvae, after metamorphosis, that is the stage of development, it returns to the ocean. So metamorphosis means from the stage of hatching of egg to the development of the adult, it is called as metamorphosis. So examples are petromycin, which is also known as lamprey, and mycin, which is also known as hagfish. So these are the examples of your cyclostomata. So one day I will keep a mentee talking only about the examples of your animal kingdom. So the questions will be like this. Hagfish is an example of. Branchiostomata is an example of. I will just have 20 questions just in the simplest form only from the examples of animal kingdom. Okay? Yes? Shall we play that? So in a way you will get thorough with the examples. So shall we have a mentee like that? Only the examples and the phyla. You should tell me, if, for example, if I say lamprey or petromycin, you should tell me the phyla there. Okay. One more way also we can play. What is the common name of petromycin? So petromycin's common name is lamprey. Okay. We will not have it for the entire chapter. Maybe we can have for the first 6 phyla and then the remaining. For the first 6 phyla, we'll have till your orthopods or till your annelids we'll have. Then the remaining chapter we'll have. Okay, so shall we play only the examples and the common name? Okay, so next week Tuesday we shall have this mentee. Done? Okay, so please prepare for the same. So in a way you will also read, so you will also be thorough. So that is the only way that I can make you learn. So the next one is class Chondrichthyes. So Chondrichthyes are marine animals. They have a streamlined body. So Chondrichthyes have cartilaginous endoskeleton. So remember Chondrichthyes, so C, so they have cartilaginous endoskeleton. Okay, so full chapter will be too tough in the initial stage. So first we'll have half the chapter and then we'll go for full chapter. So first from your Porphyra till your Annelida we'll have. Then from Orthopoda till your vertebrates we'll have on another day. Okay, so the presence of notochord. Yes, notochord persists throughout the life. So respiration, the gill slits are present, but the gill slits do not have a cover. So the cover of the gill slit is known as operculum. So I hope you understand what are gill slits, which helps in respiration. So when the gill slits are covered, so this cover is known as operculum. But your Chondrichthyes do not have this cover. They just have a naked gill slit. Okay, so the skin is tough. It contains minute placoid scales. So Chondrichthyes has placoid scales. So how you should remember CP. So this is a CP channel. So carrier point. So remember Chondrichthyes, they have placoid scales. Because there's another one which is Osteichthyes and they have cytenoid scales. So please remember Chondrichthyes have placoid scales. Okay, so this is very important. So air bladder is absent. So since the air bladder which maintains their buoyancy is absent, they have to keep continuously swimming. Otherwise, they will sink down the ocean floor. They have to continuously keep swimming. So they have a two-chambered heart. So one chamber is atria, one is ventricle. So what are the unique features? They have an electric organ in case of your torpedo. They have a poison string in case of your trigon. Maybe you can have it like this. From Porphyra till Hemichordata, we can have it on one day. Then examples of phylum Chordata, we can have it on a separate day. Because Chordata alone is a huge part. So Chordata, I will give you a separate day. Okay, so first we'll have from phylum Porphyra till phylum Hemichordata. Okay, and then another day we will have it for phylum Chordata. All right. So type, they are poikilothermous, meaning they are cold-blooded. So the sexes are separate here. The males have pelvic fins which bears claspers. So the sexes are separate. So the male and female organisms are separate. So the male has pelvic fins. So in the pelvic region, so pelvic region is where the abdominal cavity is located. In the pelvic region, they have claspers. So claspers is through which the male gamete reaches the female. Okay, so fertilization happens inside the female. So this is class Chondrichthyes. So the next one is class. So these are the examples. Your scolidon is your dogfish. So remember your Scooby-Doo. It's Scooby-Doo, right? So it is a dogfish. So remember S and S. So then you have your priest, which is your sawfish. Then you have your great white shark. And this is your trigon, which has a stingray. So moving forward, class osteotids. So this has marine and freshwater with a bony endoskeleton. That had cartilaginous endoskeleton. So this has a bony endoskeleton. So remember OBC. OBC is a cast. So osteotis has bony endoskeleton. It has sternoid scales. It has sternoid scales or cycloid scales. Whereas chondrichthyes has cartilage and it has placoid scales. It is CCP. This is OBC. So OBC is a cast, right? So remember it that way. So the body is streamed. The mouth is in the terminal position. They have gills and the gills are covered with a cover. So that is known as operculum. So the skin is covered with sternoid scales. Then we have air bladder, which regulates your buoyancy. So circulation, the heart is two chambered, one atria, one ventricle. So here it regulates buoyancy because they have an air bladder, whereas in chondrichthyes, they do not have an air bladder. So type, it is again cold-blooded, it is poikilothermic. Reproduction, it is dioecious, fertilization is external. So oviparous, meaning they lay eggs. So your chondrichthyes include all the fishes that you eat. All the edible fishes that you eat come under this, osteotids. Osteotides, I am really sorry. So these are the examples. So you have various examples. Okay, so the first type of example is marine. So they can be marine as well. They can be freshwater as well. So marine, so one type is your flying fish, the other type is your hippocampus, this is your seahorse. I hope you would have seen a seahorse. So this is your flying fish. So flying fish is exocoetus. So remember, it is an exotic species. So you do not find this at your home, right? You find this outside. So outside is exotic. So remember exocoetus, that is your flying fish, and the next one is hippocampus, which is your seahorse or your monster. Now talking about the freshwater, is all the fish that you can eat. Labyo, rohu, katla. Then you have your walking catfish, they are all edible, so that comes under your freshwater. So then in aquarium, you have your fighting fish and you have your angel fish. So this is your fighting fish and this is your angel fish. So these are examples of your osteotides. So moving to amphibia, so I guess you know what are amphibians. So they can be aquatic as well as terrestrial. So that is why they are called as amphibians, right? So hi, hello Gopal, a very, very good evening. Oh my God, after really very, very long time. How are you doing? Good? Yes, I am very good. I am hale and healthy. Thank you so much. So how are you? Are you fine? So how is your life? So thank you so much for remembering me and coming to the session. I'm really very, very glad and grateful. Yes, even I'm so excited to see your message. So please do like, share and subscribe. So thank you so much, Gopal, for coming to my session today. So the limbs, you have two pairs of limbs here, okay? You want pictures of all the examples? Go back to my Animal Kingdom lecture. So all the animals' pictures I have. So please download that PPT. You get all the pictures. So skin is moist without scale. It is moist, meaning it can respire both on land and in water. So that is the reason it is moist. The unique feature is they have eyelids and they have your ear. So tympanum is your ear, right? Yes, Gopal, you're fine. So thank you so much. So please have a great life ahead. So it's really great having you here. So please come back if you have any doubt in biology. Okay. So unique feature, they have an alimentary canal, they have a urinary and a reproductive tract, and they have only one external opening. So that is called as cloaca. So they have only one external opening. So that is called as cloaca. Yes, of course, they have a mouth, but the external opening is known as cloaca. So the respiration is through gills, lungs or through skin because it is amphibians. So circulation, the heart is three chambered. So long we were talking only about two chambered heart. So this is three chambered. So you have two atria and one ventricle. So type, it is cold-blooded, it is poikilothermous. So reproduction, once again the sexes are separate. Fertilization is external and they are once again egg-laying. So frogs lay eggs, right? So frogs are examples of your amphibians. So frog, tree frog, salamander, toad, limbless amphibia, they're all examples of your amphibians. The next one, so this is your toad, this is your tree frog, salamander, and this is your limbless amphibia. So next one, class Reptilia. So class, this is talking about your reptiles. So they are creeping, crawling mode of locomotion. So the habitat here is terrestrial. They can only live on land. So how is their body surface? This body surface is very dry and they have scutes. So scutes are dried or dead skin. They are made up of keratinized skin. So keratinized cells are dead cells. So that is what is present here. So they have no external ear. That is, they do not have your pinna region, which is a part of your fore ear. Then tympanum represents the ear. So limbs, of course, they have two pairs of limbs, except crocodile. All the others have three chambered heart. So crocodile has four chambered heart. So one more unique feature is your snakes and lizards can shed their skin and develop a new skin. This is known as echidysis. So reproduction, the sexes are separate, fertilization is internal. Once again, reptiles lay eggs. Even crocodiles lay egg. Okay, so examples of your reptiles. You have your turtle, your tortoise, your tree lizard, garden lizard. Then you have your crocodile, alligator, wall lizard, cobra. So crate and viper. So these are types of snakes. Jacobson's organ, it's not necessarily needed. You can just leave it for your need. So it will be more confusing. As such, your animal kingdom is pretty long. So please do not confuse with your state board syllabus. So restrict only to your animal kingdom, whatever is mentioned in your NCRT. Okay. So lizards too. Yes, lizards also shed their skin sometimes. But I have never seen. So please don't even imagine. Then it will come in your dreams. Fine. So moving forward. So who's losing such a good teacher? So actually Gopal was my student who got into a medical college. So he's right me pursuing his MBBS. So he just came to see me. Okay. So yes. So I'm very proud he got into medical college. So class apes. So apes is a bird. So it is the presence of flowers. So here the uniqueness is the beak. Okay. But anyway, Shimpi, so thank you so much for your compliment as well. So the limbs. So here the forelimbs are modified into wings. So they have scales, even birds have scales. So the forelimb is modified into wings. The hind limbs have scales which are helpful in walking and swimming. So some birds do swim. So skin, the skin is dry without glands. They have only one gland, that is the oil secreting gland, which is present at the base of your tail. Then the endoskeleton, the skeleton on the inner portion, it is fully ossified. It is a long bone. It has hair cavities known as pneumatic. So please remember this. They have additional chambers, that is crop and grizzard, that is present. So then circulation. So circulation is four chambered. So type warm blooded. So they are homeothermic like you and me. They are warm blooded. So even if you pour ice on you, even if you pour ice water on you, still your internal body temperature is the same. You're able to regulate the temperature. So we are warm blooded. So your crop and grizzard also comes in your cockroach. So I hope you remember. The digestive system of cockroach. So then respiration, they respire through the lungs along with air sacs. Okay, so this helps them in flying, the design of their endoskeleton. So reproduction, of course, you have a male bird and a female bird and they lay eggs. So examples of the bird, crow, pigeon, parrot, ostrich, peacock, penguin, vulture. So all these are examples, right? Yes, so shall we move forward? So mammals are made up of polar ice crab. Okay, yes, I'm waiting, Anthony. So I want all of you to become doctors. So next year, by this time, everyone should be a medical college student. Okay, so shall we move forward? Yes, so habitat. So your mammals, we can live everywhere from the Himalayan, snow-filled Himalayan regions to mountains, forests, grasslands, etc. So everywhere you have your mammals present. So adaptation, they're adapted to fly. So like your bats, they're adapted to live in water, like your dolphins. And like us, we are living on land. Okay, we are not flying or crawling or climbing. We are just staying safe at home. Talking about the current situation. So pygostyle, once again, it's a complex term. We are not confusing here. Okay, FF lovers. Okay, so limbs. So one unique characteristic is we have milk-producing glands, which is called as mammary glands, and the limbs are two pairs which are adopted for walking, running, climbing, etc. So the skin possesses hairs which causes goosebumps for us. Then ears, we have external ear that is pinna. So we have teeth, and what is the dental formula? 2123 by 2123. This is in case of humans. I'm just recollecting. The heart is four chambered. We have two atria and two ventricles. We are once again warm blooded. We respire through lungs, and of course we are dioecious. We have a male and a female separately. So who are the examples of mammals? Kangaroo, flying fox. So flying fox, fox are your bats. Then we have your camels. We have your monkey, rat, dog, cat, elephant, horse, common dolphin, blue whale, tiger, etc. So it is a kind of protection for us. Sometimes it protects us from the temperature, sometimes it protects us from pathogens. So that is the reason we have hair on our skin. So that is it. So shall we go to the question part? So with this we come to an end of your animal kingdom. So shall we talk about the questions here? Yes, any more doubts in animal kingdom? No? So shall we talk about the question? So here we go, question 1 of your animal kingdom. So solve this. So diploblastic and triploblastic are the terms that describe which of the following? The number of germinal layers during embryonic development. Yes, perfectly right. You guys have understood the concept. So moving on to question number 2. Which is not correct for sponges? Not correct. Internal fertilization, external fertilization, gamete formation. Gametes are formed from epidermal cells. So what is the answer for question number 2? What is the answer for question number 2? Which is not correct for sponges? Internal fertilization, external fertilization, gamete formation. Gametes are formed from epidermal cells. Why is D? So in sponges also you have sexual reproduction where they produce gametes. So gametes are formed from epidermal cells. This is right. So just now I told you about gametes. Yes. So in sponges, the fertilization is internal. It is not external. That this is the wrong statement. So here the answer is option B. So in sponges, the fertilization is internal, not external. Fine. Yes, clear. Okay, moving on to question number 3. Stinging capsules, which is also known as nematocysts, are found in which of the following two pairs? Scypha and your brain coral, Cleona and Chalina. So then your sea pen and your sea fan, Grantia and Bellala. So you can clearly eliminate these two. We have not spoken about these two. So Scypha is your finger-like sponge. Because we have read all the examples of your coelenterate. We do not have any new examples. So which one will be the answer? So your nematocysts belong to coelenterata. So now tell me which one is the right option? Yes, your sea fan and your sea fan. So brain colon, yes, has nematocysts, but this option is wrong. So we are eliminating A, B and D. So the right answer here is C. So Penatula and Gorgonia. So Penatula is your sea pen, Gorgonia is your sea fan. So moving on to question number 4, a common characteristic of all vertebrates without exception is the body is divided into head, neck, trunk and tail. Their body is covered with an exoskeleton. So the possession of 2 pairs of functional appendages, the presence of well-developed skull. Which is the most common feature? Without any exception, all vertebrates have this. All vertebrates, not chordates, all vertebrates. So what is the answer here? Yes, what is the answer here? So all vertebrates possesses 2 pairs of functional appendages. Do we have 2 pairs of functional appendages? So all vertebrates. So under vertebrates, you have your amphibians, you have your reptiles, you have your birds, etc. So do they also have 2 pairs? So do we have a tail? Do we have a tail? We are also vertebrates. Do we have a tail? Yes, do we have a tail? Let me know. I don't have. Do you have? Turn around. Yes, the presence of well-developed skull. So all of the vertebrates have a well-developed skull. So your answer is option D. So this is the most common characteristic here, that is option D. Fine. So moving on to question number 5. Which of the following are not the characteristic of class Osteothyrus? So what I told you to remember, OBC. Osteothyrus have bony endoskeleton, and they have cytenoid or cycloid scales, right? So body is streamlined and the mouth is terminal. Gills are covered by operculum. The skin is covered with cycloid and placoid scales. Many of them are viviparous. Which of the following is not the characteristic? So they have only one type. Right, they have only cycloids, so 3 is wrong. So many of them are viviparous. No, all of them are egg-laying. So the first 2 are right, the last 2 are wrong. So your answer is option B. You agree? Not A. So even this is wrong. You have both the scales. No, right? You have. So the options are here. This is not the options. This is the option. So these are the statements. So please be careful with the statements and the options. So your 3rd and your 4th statement are wrong. So shall we move forward to question number 6? So what is common between an earthworm and a periplaneta? So earthworm belongs to phylum Annelida. So periplaneta is your cockroach. So cockroach belongs to your Orthopoda. So what is common between those two? So both have red colored blood. So from cockroach we know cockroach has white colored blood. So both possesses anal tails. So no, anal tails are common only in case of your cockroach, not in case of your earthworm. So both have Malpighian tubules. No, one has nephridia, one has Malpighian tubules. Both have segmented body. Earthworm also is known for segmentation. Your cockroach is also segmented. How is your cockroach segmented? Head, thorax and your abdomen. Right? So your right answer is option D. So this is question number 6. So moving on to question number 7. Among the following organisms, which one is completely non-parasitic form? Which is not a parasite, I'm asking you. Sea anemone, tapeworm, leech or mosquito. Which is not a parasite? So from the given 4 examples, which of the following is not a parasite? Yes, sea anemone is not a parasite, so it is marine, whereas your tapeworm can be present inside your stomach. So leech is blood sucking, mosquito is also blood sucking. Yes, very good. So question number 8, so bilateral symmetry, segmentation, coelom and open circulatory system characterizes which of the following phyla? Annelida, molluscus, orthopod, echinodermata. So Annelida is bilateral, is segmented, it is coelom, but this has closed circulatory system. Whereas your molluscus does not have yes, a circulatory system at all. Orthopods have an open circulatory system. In echinodermata, it is radial symmetry. So these are features of your orthopoda. Yes, you're right. It is option C. Okay? You understand why it is option C? Okay, so I hope you have understood. So moving forward to the next question. So question number 9. So amphibians share with reptiles all of the following characters except one. So there's a lot of things are common between amphibians and reptiles except one. A ventral heart, external fertilization and indirect development, dioecious and oviparous, cold-blooded or poikilotherms. So cold-blooded and poikilotherms is the same one. So what is the difference here? So oviparous is egg-laying. Yes, both are egg-laying. Both are cold-blooded. Yes, we agree. So only your eels are warm-blooded. So before that, everyone is cold-blooded. So this is common. This is common. Yes, they have separate sexes. You have separate male and female. So both of them have heart, right? So amphibians have three-chambered heart. Reptiles also have three-chambered with the exception of crocodile. Yes, external fertilization and indirect development. So in certain cases, the fertilization is internal. In case of reptiles, the fertilization is internal. So here your right answer is option B. Yes, very good. So moving to the last question of the evening. So which of the following character is absent in all chordates except your mammals? Sternum, coelom, mammary glands, dorsal nerve cord. Is absent in all chordates except your mammals. So what is the most unique feature of your mammals? Yes. What is the most unique feature? No, it is your mammary glands. So all chordates do not have mammary glands. Only your mammals have your mammary glands. So here your option is C. Okay, so I just got 10 questions. So with this, we are done discussing all the 10 questions. So this is the announcement for tomorrow. So tomorrow at 4 p.m., we are meeting to complete transport and plans. We will try our best. It's okay, Shimpi. So you please go through the NCRT. So you will gradually begin to understand. All right. So at 4, we'll try to complete transport and plans. We'll try our best. And at 6:30, we have a something different session which talks about stay safe and stay strong. So we are going to talk about your symptoms, the precautions that you take, all that that is needed to stay or survive this hectic period. Okay? Yes. So please make sure you attend both of my sessions. I promise I will not disappoint you. So if you genuinely like my session, so please do like, share and subscribe. So Abneet ma'am is done with Plant Kingdom. So Plant Kingdom is completed in syllabus wrap-up series. If so, then we can have a mentee for the syllabus wrap-up series. So the winner of the mentee will get a free mock test series, right? As promised, I will get you the mock test series. So tell me, Plant Kingdom is done in your syllabus wrap-up series? Yesterday you had your syllabus wrap-up series, right? Plant Kingdom is done? Okay, if your Plant Kingdom... Yes, we are going in order in your plant physiology, so don't worry. So if your Plant Kingdom is done, so I will plan a mentee soon, a mega mentee where we'll talk about all the four topics. Okay, so Plant Kingdom is not done. All right, so we will continue. So thank you so much for being a wonderful audience and thank you so much for joining me at this late hour from 6:30 to 7:30. It is really great having an interaction with you. So it's my pleasure talking with you and making a change in your life. So stay tuned and get back to me. So this is me signing off. So have a great night. Bye and take care.